Professor Dave and Chegg here. We have been learning quite a bit about galvanic cells. These utilize a spontaneous redox reaction to generate an electric current, which can then be utilized to power electronic devices. But there are other types of electrochemical cells, such as electrolytic cells. This is where an electric current is utilized in order to drive an otherwise non-spontaneous redox reaction. This will be important to understand as well, so let's get a closer look at this now.
Let's look at water to see an example of electrolysis. Water is a stable molecule. It does not spontaneously undergo a redox reaction to become hydrogen gas and oxygen gas. But if we put some electrodes in water to form an electrolytic cell, electrons from the current that is generated can facilitate this chemistry, and water molecules will indeed split up into hydrogen and oxygen molecules. So the same principles of oxidation and reduction and electron flow that are present in galvanic cells also apply in electrolytic cells. The two just run in opposite directions, one from chemical energy to electrical energy, and the other one from electrical energy to chemical energy. Another example of an electrolytic cell is the type of battery found in an electric car. The battery charges up when plugged into a source of electricity and then can be used to power the car. Now that we know the definition of an electrolytic cell, let's look at a few examples of electrolytic solutions to see exactly what is going on at the anode and cathode in each case. First, let's examine the electrolysis of molten sodium chloride. Here, electrons from the current go and reduce sodium ions in solution, which then deposit onto the cathode. Chloride ions then oxidize as they deposit onto the anode. Of course, this is a non-spontaneous process, so it will require a minimum of 4 volts in the way of a supplied electric current to occur. We can see why this is the case if we look at the half-reactions associated with this cell. The E cell for the overall reaction is negative 4 volts, and this is why this is the minimum voltage that must be applied in order to drive the reaction. Now let's revisit the electrolysis of water. In this process, an electric current is used to split up water molecules into hydrogen molecules and oxygen molecules. Acids like sulfuric acid are typically used to increase the concentration of hydrogen ions in solution, which helps facilitate the reaction at the cathode. Let's take a look at the half-reactions now. We can see that at the anode, water is oxidized and generates oxygen molecules, as well as the hydrogen ions that move towards the cathode, where they are reduced to become water molecules. We can see that the cell potential is negative 1.229 volts, which means that the minimum voltage that must be applied to this electrolytic cell in order to drive the reaction will be 1.229 volts. Lastly, let's examine the electrolysis of aqueous sodium chloride. The interesting thing about this electrolytic cell is that more than one species could be oxidized or reduced. Let's see what could happen at the anode. First, we know from electrolysis of molten sodium chloride that chloride ions can be oxidized. But we know from the electrolysis of water that water molecules can be oxidized. So these are the two possible reactions at the anode. Now let's see what could happen at the cathode. Hydrogen ions could be reduced, water molecules could be reduced, or sodium ions could be reduced. Now let's talk about the likelihood of each half reaction. Remember that E cell is going to be equal to E cathode minus E anode, and a more positive value for E cell is more favorable. So these two half reactions, the most positive anode half reaction and the most negative cathode half reaction, seem unlikely. But it turns out that in actuality, oxidation of chloride does occur because of the overpotential of water oxidation, or the difference between the predicted and actual cell voltage, and water is reduced because despite the more negative potential, hydrogen ions are too scarce in neutral solution for the first reaction to be competitive. So this will be the overall reaction for the cell, which means 2.186 volts are required to drive this electrolysis. Let's check out a couple other types of calculations that will be useful. First, we must know that current is given in amperes, which are the same as coulombs per second, and the total charge in coulombs, or Q, is given by either the current times the time the current is running, which is coulombs per second times seconds, or the moles of electrons transferred, times something called Faraday's constant, which is moles times coulombs per mole, because Faraday's constant represents 1 mole of elementary charges. So that gives us a way to convert between the strength of an electric current and the moles of electrons involved in the redox reaction. Let's see this in action. Say that an electric current of 10.23 amperes passes through an electrolytic cell for 1 hour. How many moles of electrons pass through the cell in this time? Well, let's return to our two equations for Q. Let's use the first one to solve for Q. Now we can plug this value of Q into this equation and solve for N. Doing the arithmetic, we get 0.3817 moles of electrons that must have passed through the cell in 1 hour to generate the current. Now let's try something a little trickier. Say we have a 3.3 square meter surface, and through electrolysis of a chromium-3 solution, we want to cover this surface with a 0.01 millimeter layer of solid chromium. If the density of chromium is 7.19 grams per cubic centimeter, and the current running through the cell is 33.46 amperes, how long will this take? Well, first let's understand that we need to determine the total charge required for this to happen, and in order to do that, we need to know how many chromium ions have to be reduced. So first, let's figure out the volume of this chromium layer. That will be the area of the layer times the height of the layer. Let's convert both of them into centimeters, since that's what the density of chromium is given in, and multiplying height times area gives us 33 cubic centimeters. 33 cubic centimeters of chromium atoms are needed to form this layer. Let's then use the density of chromium to figure out the mass of chromium that volume represents. 33 cubic centimeters times 7.19 grams per cubic centimeter gives us 237 grams of chromium. That's the mass of chromium needed to generate the layer. Then we can use the molar mass of chromium to get the moles of chromium atoms this represents. 237 grams times 1 mole for every 52 grams gives us 4.56 moles of chromium atoms. Now, each chromium atom will need 3 electrons to go from chromium 3 to a neutral chromium atom. So let's take this number of moles and multiply by 3 to get the number of moles of electrons needed to reduce all these chromium ions. And from moles of electrons, we just multiply by Faraday's constant to get the charge of all those electrons in coulombs. Now that we know the charge in coulombs, we can take this equation relating charge, current, and time, plug in the charge we solved for and the current given, and we can solve for T. That will give us around 11 hours that the current will have to run in order to generate the desired layer of chromium. So in this way, we have gone from the volume of the desired layer to the volume of chromium needed to form it, to the mass of chromium needed, to the moles of chromium needed, to the moles of electron that must be transferred, to the total charge those electrons represent, to the time the current must run to provide that charge transfer.
So we now know about different types of electrochemical cells, those being galvanic cells and electrolytic cells. And with that, we wrap up our introduction to electrochemistry. Professor Dave for Chegg. See you next time.